My name is Zach Bales. I'm the co-curator of the International Paranormal Museum and Research Center in Somerset, Kentucky, and I'm the webmaster for www.paranormalroadtripper.net. Several years ago, I got into exploring the paranormal. I got into it because of ghost stories primarily, but I was always told about a kind of a river near where I live, just a few counties away in south central Kentucky, called Green River. One evening, I decided to put some of the stories I'd heard to the test, and I'd heard stories for quite some time about a large hominid, kind of a hairy creature of some sort, a Bigfoot, if you will, that had been seen in this noted duck preserve, as I said, near where I'm from, along the shores of Green River. Me and my wife decided to put the stories to the test and spend the night on the banks of Green River one evening. It was a cold evening, I believe it was in November of the year, and we set up our tent, and we had always heard that one way to lure these types of creatures in would be to put some sort of a pungent pet food, something would get, you know, a scent in the air and try to get the creatures to approach our place where we were spending the night. And that's what we did. We put several pungent dog and cat food types of, around the campsite, built a fire, and spent the evening, had a good evening. We hadn't really had much activity. We had done a number of the whoop calls that we had heard were popular to kind of lure the things in, as well as some tree knocking. Hadn't really had any luck. We had a good time, roasted some hot dogs and whatnot. We called it a night and went to bed in our tent that evening. I woke up several hours after we went to sleep, and I don't know necessarily what it was that woke me up, but I do know that when I woke up, it was one of those moments when you wake, you kind of sense that something's not right. And I woke up in my sleeping bag, and I had that, you know, the pins and needles feeling all over, that something was a little off. And so as I rolled over to, you know, check on, at the time it was my girlfriend, now it's my wife, Melissa, I was shocked to learn that she wasn't asleep either. As a matter of fact, she was kind of up on, she's wide awake. She was kind of up out of her sleeping bag, and I've never really seen a look on someone's face quite like it. Matter of fact, just talking about it right now, it kind of gives me the willies. She was kind of consumed in fear, and it caught me off guard. It was the last thing I expected. It was still dark outside. You could still hear the, you know, just maybe the sizzle of our campfire, which had very nearly died at this point, outside the tent. Other than that, it was all quiet as I turned to look at her, and I saw this look on her face, a look of absolute fear. And I started to, you know, question. It's the kind of thing you would automatically ask someone you know, what's wrong? Well, I started to talk, and she cut me off. Her hand, her finger went to her lips, and she, you know, motioned me to be absolutely quiet. And that also caught me a little off guard. And as I started to connect all the dots, what was going on, that's when I heard it. And it's a sound I hadn't really heard at all that night, and not really ever since. Something large, much larger than what I would consider to be the sound of a human being walking. Something large, a large animal, on the other side of Green River, which we were suffering from a drought at the time, and the river was more of a creek at the time, it was very shallow. We heard crunch along the bank on the other side of the river. Crunch, crunch, crunch. The next thing I knew, whatever it was, wasn't on the bank anymore, it was in the river itself. And we heard splash, splash, splash. It didn't take too many of those splash sounds to realize that whatever it was on its way across the river, and whatever it was probably on its way into our encampment. We heard splash, splash, and with each successive splash, I grew a little more concerned. And, you know, all I could do was continue, my eyes locked on my wife, who was, you know, pale at this point, quite pale, quite scared. I think we both were. I don't think I realized the severity of the situation until whatever it was on the our side of the creek. Crunch, crunch, we heard again, as now it was out of the water and in the rocky, this beached type area that we were camped out upon. We heard crunch, crunch, it got closer and closer. And the next thing I knew, I heard what sounded like something sniffing. You know, kind of a really guttural sniffing sound, as if whatever it was was sniffing maybe the remnants of our campfire, or maybe the pungent food, the fruits, and I don't even know what kind at this point, salmon flavored cat food, dog, whatever it was. Well, I put it out of my mind at this point. This is the last thing I was thinking about was the food. What I was thinking about was what it was about to make food of us. Because whatever it was, we heard crunch, 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 and the next thing I knew, whatever it was right outside the tent. The only thing separating me and my wife from whatever it was, being a thin sheet of nylon, maybe? Well, we sat there for a minute, and we listened to this, whatever this creature, sniff around, crunch as it got closer and closer, and the one thing I remember about the entire encounter was the noise it made. Because right about that time, it let out a roar the likes that I had not heard. It sounded like it would have been heard for miles. I'm talking an earth-shattering roar on the other side of that tent. So loud that I can very nearly hear it to this day. I mean, it shook me to the core, and it made me realize just then and there how really unprepared that we were for what we were doing. We had went into the lion's den, you might say, with nothing more than a tent, a campfire, you know, and our wits about us, I guess, or at least we thought we had them at the time. And what we had done was lure something large. Now, whether or not that was the creature that was purported to haunt the banks of Green River, we didn't know. Because all I wanted to do at that moment was keep absolutely still and absolutely quiet. And it let out that roar, and then it took off. Crunch, crunch, crunch. It walked up the bank, and we heard as we listened as it kind of scurried into a cornfield. It was on the other side of a narrow gravel road that kind of led us into this duck reserve. And we listened for probably 10 or 15 minutes as it slowly sifted through the corn on its way out of the area. We never found out what exactly that was, but it certainly gave us a much greater respect for the power of nature and what it is that we got ourselves into. We don't really frequent Green River that much anymore, and I've never really seen anyone write necessarily any stories or do much filming. There's not really a lot of publicity to whatever this creature was. But I've coined the term the Green River Monster. It's something that I typically, when I refer to it as that, me and my wife know what I mean. And I actually have written a couple books. As I said, I started with ghosts. I've written two books on this subject, The Amateur's Guide to Ghost Hunting by Zach Bales and The Expert's Guide to Ghost Hunting by Zach Bales. And I always try to include other chapters because I'm a fervent believer not just in ghosts, but in all sorts of unexplained phenomena. And one of the chapters, titled The Green River Monster, recounts the exact story that I just told you. And it was a game changer for me and her and made us realize, you know, maybe there is more to these legends that you hear about these creatures far and wide. And there's more to it than meets the eye.